Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
We are going to be trying some new things. First of all, I want to welcome you to our first time back here on Wednesday evening Bible study, our time of praise, prayer, and preaching of God's Word. But we're also doing this video. We're on Facebook Live right now, so maybe there might be one person in the entire world watching me right now, because that's about my human audience. And it might be my wife, but I don't know if she wants. Nonetheless, we are going to take this live for the benefit of those in our church that are not able to be here or at this moment in time do not feel comfortable coming in. And so we're also going to attempt to, once we do this Facebook Live, we're also going to attempt to capture the video and place that on our website and also attach it to our YouTube channel. And so we're trying something new. But I do want to welcome you tonight as we continue our study of God's Word. As you know, you can have your Bibles already there. We are in 1 John, and we'll be looking at 1 John chapter 4, verses 7 through 16, and we'll get to the message in a moment. But I do want to open us up with prayer, and then Brother Harry is going to lead us all in congregational singing. What's the hymn?
223.
223. So you can turn there, because he's going to sing and play on the piano. And then we'll go ahead and sing to him, and Brother Harry's going to lead us in a time of prayer, and then I'll come back, and we'll have the preaching of God's precious word. So let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, we praise you. We thank you for the opportunity we have to gather in your name. We're thankful, Lord God, that you have made it so that we can gather here in person, and we're thankful, Lord God, that we can do so in a safe means. I do pray for our time together. I pray, Lord God, that we will be empowered by your Spirit. I pray, Lord God,
to sing along and joining in that. And I was reading, I've been reading everything that has come across my desk or the internet regarding singing, because that's my ministry, it's my lifeblood. And I've been reading a couple of articles that were written by pulmonologists. And one of the things that the articles said from the pulmonologists that we may be tricking folks into thinking that when we sing, we project water droplets or whatever a lot farther than we really do. So I think it's safe for us to sing, unless you are actually within about a foot and a half or 2 feet of somebody, which you don't need to be anyway in church. But unless you're about 2 feet from somebody's face, I think we're going to be okay. So let's continue to praise the Lord, all right? Now, we want to remember some birthdays that are coming up. Lance Coleman has a birthday coming up. Antoinette Gannon has a birthday. And Madison Holt, is she a teenager? She's not quite a teenager yet. She's still a child. And also, Jan Coe has a birthday coming up. So I'd like for you to join me in singing Happy Birthday to them. Happy birthday to you. To lead direct our paths, Lord, so that we might go to, speak to, and pray with the right people. I pray especially, Lord, for our search for our church organs. Thank you, Lord, for those who have been willing to help out in the interim. But, Lord, we know that you are preparing someone to join our staff and our family. We pray for them. Thank you, Lord, for each of these respective ministries, for the work that they do, touching hearts and lives. In Jesus' name. As we look at our missionary of the week, Megan Williams is a college student at the University of Florida at Santa Fe College, and she shares the gospel with students. She also feels rewarded. She often feels rewarded, but oftentimes she feels like that she's going against the current. And I know that all of us have felt like that, whether in college or in our neighborhoods or whatever. So pray for her as she prays, as she leads small groups on campuses, and that they will be used to help lost people feel welcome and open to learning more about Christ. We also want to pray for Oakdale Baptist Church and our association. Their pastor is Reverend Steve Hayes. I almost said that wrong. And we want to pray for the director of Florence County EMS, Chief Ryan Watkins. Brother Mike, would you lead us as we pray for these?
Oh, Father God, we do come to you again in prayer. Father, we ask you to please, please be with all the ministries that are going on in our community, Father. Especially this week, we pray for our sister church, for Oakdale Baptist Church, and for Reverend Hayes that's there. And Father, we pray for all the churches that are trying to find innovative ways that they can minister to the congregation and can minister to the community at large, Father. Father, we ask you to watch over and protect and encourage and direct the churches, the ministers, and the staff as they try so hard to continue serving both their membership and the community at large. Father, we also ask you to be with all of our public officials, Father. Give each one of them godly wisdom. This week, Father, we especially pray for our Florence County Director of Emergency Services, Ryan Watkins, Father. We ask you to watch over him, watch over his staff, watch over the important tasks that they have. Keep them safe during this time, Father. Allow them all to be able to end each day and turn back home to the safety of their household and to their family. And all these things, Father, we ask for your protection. We ask you to put a shield around each and every one, Father, and minister to the needs of each and every one has. In Christ's name we ask this, Father. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. As we look at our personal prayer concerns, I want you to add a couple there. Please continue to pray for Carol Henderson. She had surgery yesterday, but she's doing great. I talked to Laura today, and she is home and just doing wonderful, but she needs our prayer here this time. I want to continue to pray for Eileen Owens. Eileen was scheduled to have cataract surgery. I think that's correct. And she's just having so much problem with her back pain. So we want to pray for her. And of course, we want to pray for the family of Marie Maiden. Marie passed away on June the 9th, and she was 106 years old.
105.
That turned into 6. Isn't that awesome, though, to think of all the change that she has seen over her lifetime? She loved her church, she loved her church family, and I continue to pray for them. They'll have a private service in Johnston, South Carolina, which is north of 8. Now, we want to also lift up these on our prayer list. We want to continue to pray for Morris Anderson, or Hank Anderson, Flory Andrews, Bob Ashcraft, Ann Atkinson, Aaron Bayer, Nan Barker, Dana Boatwright, Lynn Brown, Michelle Budden, Anna Carter, Sandy Carter, William Chandler, Jennifer Cockfield, Mary Catherine Coleman, Dolores Davis, John Davis, who's recovering from surgery, Sarah Duff, Mike Easton, Beth Thor, Francis Floyd, Angela Gardner, Ruth Grayson, Gail Harley, I understand she's doing better, Debbie Waters Lindrum, Miriam Moody, my brother-in-law, Hooper Mara, is kind of up and down with, but anyway, he has a long-term disease. Joshua Rindleman, Kate Richards, Diane Richardson, Lanier Singleton, Carter Smith, Oliver Smith, Jimmy Walsh, Laura Waters, and Nellie and Buddy Watts. Are there others that we need to add to our list?
Times in the Word of God when start the day, mankind can't do any worse. But then there are times when you look, you see what's going on in this world because of the mighty God, and life is just lifted up, especially when we think about some of the glorious passages that takes us on heaven in the future. It is just a wonderful thing. However, there are 25 words that perhaps explains it all. You understand those words as John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life." When you think about the Word of God, it is his love letter to you and to me. Truly, we have a faith that loves. As we've been studying 1 John, and we're coming to the end of 1 John, and we'll continue with the epistle of 2 John and 3 John, the theme really is that we have a faith that loves. And without a doubt, love is found throughout the Word of God. As I said before, from Genesis to Revelations, we see the very love of God coming through. One of the amazing things when you think about the love of God in this epistle that we've been studying, God's love is so evident in this passage that we're getting ready to read. The term or the phrase "God is love" is found twice just in these 10 verses that we are getting ready to read. God is love, and our Christian faith is based upon that love. And so with that in mind, I'm going to read 1 John chapter 4, beginning verse 7 through verse 16. The title of this evening's passage is "God is," obviously, "God is love." 1 John chapter 4, verse 7. "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who is loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world, that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we know, we have known that the love, and we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, again, we praise you simply for the precious reading of your word. We're so thankful, Lord God, for the clarity that you give us, not only in the simple writing, but in the promise of your Holy Spirit, who is our teacher and our guide. And so we pray this evening, Lord God, that we'll allow your Spirit to speak to our hearts. We'll allow your word to lodge within our hearts, and that we will be changed for the cause of Christ. Bless this time that we have together in your word. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's a children's course that perhaps you remember that states this wonderful truth that God is love. It goes something like this: praise him, praise him, praise him, all you little children. God is what? God is love. God is love. It goes on: love him, love him, love them, all you little children. God is love. God is love. It doesn't stop there. We can thank him as well. Thank him. Thank him, all you little children. God is love. God is love. They must be calling you, telling me I better speak up. God is love. And not only is it expressed in this passage, not just on those two occasions, but throughout the precious Word of God. As we get to this reality of the love of God, and God is love, there are important things I want to share this evening that helps us to, I think, better understand what it means by God is love and what it means to us as followers of Jesus Christ. So here's the first thing I want us to take note of in this passage we just read. We should take note of the provision of God's love. The provision of God's love. Let me read verses 7 and 8 again. John writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God, and everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love." Now, this is the provision of God's love. And what does that exactly mean? Well, let me add a few things to this. First of all, we see that this is a provision of God's love because God provides, for he is love. That's the passage there that says God is love. It's the Greek phrase, katheis agapen estin. And the tense of that phrase in the Greek gives us two clear understandings. First of all, it gives us a clear understanding that God's love is eternal in nature. In other words, that future present tense of that phrase, katheis agapen estin, means that God's love does not stop. It is not fleeting, it does not come, it does not go, it doesn't wax, it doesn't wane. God's love continues, and it is consistent and continuous. In other words, you and I cannot change his love. You and I cannot thwart the love of God. You and I cannot stop the love of God. God is love. And so we find here the eternal nature of God's love. But that phrase in its tense also signifies the essence of God's nature is love. So when we think about God is love, love is not some psychological babble. It is not some feeling we get. No, the very essence of God, his nature is love. No wonder it is eternal, because God is eternal. No wonder it is perfect, because God is perfect. And no wonder it saturates everything that God does, because God is love. It's the very nature, it's the essence of an almighty God. God provides, for he is love. Secondly, God provides, because he does love. There's a difference between saying God is love, the very essence of God is love, and saying that God loves you. How many times have we watched, say, Billy Graham preach on TV, in person, however? How often have you heard him say to the congregation, "If you forget everything I've said tonight, remember this, God loves you." You see, not only do we find that the very nature, the essence of God, and the eternal nature of God is love, but that he places that love upon us. I am amazed, I am so amazed that God would love a wretched soul like me. Amen. And let me just be bold enough to say, I'm surprised he loves a wretched soul like you as well. But God loves us. God provides, for he is love. God provides, for he does love. In this passage it says, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God." God is love. Love is of God. Isn't that just amazing? And he provides that love to us. I quoted a moment ago that wonderful passage of John 3:16, "For God so loved the world." It demonstrates not only that God is love, but that he's placed his love upon mankind. And it amazes me that he does so. There's another passage, Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that gives us that wonderful understanding of God's love. It says, God demonstrated his love for us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. God is love. God loves us. And that is just so amazing. It's the provision of God. He provides, for he is love. God provides, for he does love. Now here's the third part of that. God provides, for he expects us to love. And say that again. God provides, for he expects us to love. Let me just be honest with you for a moment. Like, you probably want your pastor to always be honest with you, don't you? Let me be honest with you. I'm not always a very loving person. I'm not always a very lovable places is love inside of you.
How else can we love one another if God's love isn't right here within us? Beloved, let us love one another, John says in this passage, and everyone who loves is born of God, because we're born of God. We have the very love of God within us, and we can share the love of God with other people. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. And he who does not love, listen, you can't have love for a fellow man. It says they do not know God.
Wow.
God is love. God loves you and loves me. God's love is within us so that we can love others. That's the very provision of an almighty God. And so we begin looking at the provision of God's love. That's how he brings us to the second point. Really, we see this in verses 9 through 11. We also can find here the purpose of God's love. Now, ultimately, the purpose of God's love is summed up in his own nature. Because God is love, listen, that's the purpose of his love, because that's who he is. But there are other things we can discover, especially from this passage, about the purpose of God's love. Let me read again verses 9 through 11. In this, the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. When we think about the purposes of God's love, let me just share with you. You might even call these subcategories or sub-purposes to match his very nature and to match what everything is about, the glory of God. But think about these purposes. One purpose is to reveal his love to us. One of the purposes of God's love is that we would know it, so that he can reveal it to us. It says in this passage, in this, the love of God, this it was manifested towards us. In other words, we don't discover the love of God. In the Christian faith, I discovered this passage of scripture that really spoke. You didn't discover nothing. God revealed it to you. He manifested towards you. And that's how his love is. His love is manifested. It's revealed to us. One of the purposes of God's love is to reveal to us just how loving he is. Here's another purpose. The second purpose is to redeem us with his love. To reveal to us his love, but also to redeem us by his love. That God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be a propitiation for our sins. God did not create us because he needed us to worship him. God needs nothing from me. He needs nothing from you. We are created because God loves us, not because he needs our love. He created us with this perfect understanding. He created us understanding that we would mess it up. He created us with his omniscience and his omnipotence and his omnipresence, knowing that mankind was going to sin in the Garden of Eden, and that sin would saturate the very nature of man. God knew from the very beginning that his Son would be sent to this earth to put on human flesh, to die upon the cross at Calvary for the sins of the world. God knew all this, and yet he sent his Son to us. In other words, his love, the purpose is not only to reveal his love to us, but to redeem us. He died, his Son died as a propitiation for our sins. That Greek word for propitiation means to offer an appeasement, to satisfy the wrath, to pay a penalty. Jesus paid the price for me and for you on the cross at Calvary. He redeemed us. And that's one of the purposes of God's love. Not only to reveal his love to us, but he revealed it by redeeming us. Let me share it. Those are the two primary reasons. The purpose of God's love to reveal his love to us, to redeem us by his love. So here's the truth. When we're established in his love, we must reciprocate his love to others. That's the third part, the third purpose. He reveals his love to us. He helps us to understand that we are redeemed by his love. Why? That we can reciprocate his love, that we can show his love to others. Everything about the goodness of God is placed within our lives that we can share. We're not to take one thing that God gives to us and keep to ourselves. That's not the purpose. You know, when you think about the passages that talks about the comfort that we are given of God, we are comforted so that we may comfort others. When we're given the gospel message, it is given to us that we can give it to others. When we know the very love of God, it is brought to us that we can give the love of God to others. We're to reciprocate his love to others. In verse 11, it's put this way, that love. If God so loved us, let me ask you this question. Do you think God loves you? I would probably yell, amen, at the top of my lungs. God loves me. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. Now, let me just add some emphasis. You know that word ought? We probably say, well, that means I don't have to. Oh, no. Love is given to us that we would love one another. In fact, Jesus tells us in John chapter 13, verse 35, the only way they're going to know that we are disciples of him isn't because we can quote scripture. It isn't because we can preach from the pulpit. It isn't because my daddy was a deacon and my mom played the piano. No, that's not how they know we are followers of Jesus Christ. They know we are followers of Jesus Christ when we love one another.
Amen.
We are reciprocating his love to others. The purpose of God's love is to reveal his love to us, to redeem us by his love, so that in his love we can share the love of God.
The purpose of his love.
Here's a third part of this. We also see here the proof of God's love. Look, if you will, now at verses 12 through 14. No one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. By this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as the Savior of the world. The proof of God's love. It almost sounds contradictory in this passage. We're talking about the proof of God's love, but it says no one has seen God at any time. So how on earth do we know, how on earth do we have that proof of God's love? Well, let's go on and look at that passage a little closer. First of all, we see in verses 12 through 14, specifically in verse 12, he is perfecting his love in us. In those who call upon the name of Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, God is perfecting his love in us. Verse 12, no one has seen God at any time. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. In the English Standard Version, it reads thusly, no one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. In other words, you and I, as followers of Jesus Christ, are actively engaged in this world to demonstrate, to reciprocate the love of God, and God's love is therefore in our lives being perfected so that we can demonstrate, we can prove the love of God to others. He is perfecting his love in us. You see, God is invisible, and so sometimes his love has to be seen through you and through me. God's Son is no longer visible through this world. So the manifestation of the love of God, the love of Jesus Christ, must be seen through the Christian body. We're the people of God, and he is perfecting his love in us. Here's another area of proof. Not only is he perfecting his love in us, but how does he perfect his love in us? Well, it takes place because of his presence in us. In other words, by this we know that we abide in him, and he in us, God God in me, because now he has given to us his Spirit. I read a moment ago, Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, that God demonstrates his love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. A couple verses prior to that, we realize the very hope that is found in this love. Romans chapter 5 and verse 5. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God, listen, the love of God has been poured out into us, has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Remember the promise of Christ, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That's the promise of the Holy Spirit within us. Remember the promise that has been uttered in the Old Testament and restated in the New Testament, I will never leave you nor forsake you. God in us is the Holy Spirit of God. He is present within us. And because we have the Holy Spirit indwelling us, we have the proof of the love of God. And then thirdly, because he has paid the price for us. How can we prove the love of God? Because he paid the price. He left the very glories of heaven. He put on human flesh. He ministered upon this earth in the person of Jesus Christ. He taught about the kingdom truths. He cast out demons. He healed the lame. He let the blind to see. He forgave sins. And then he died upon the cross for our sins. He paid the price, verse 14, and we have seen and testify. Think about this. John the Apostle, writing this epistle many years later, says, listen, I was there. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. The ultimate proof of God's love is that God came down from heaven, put on human flesh, and died upon the cross at Calvary. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had nothing. Crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He paid the price that I couldn't pay. That's what he did. And he paid the price that you could not pay as well. The proof of God's love. Let me just state the obvious here. God is love. The proof is that he's perfecting his love in us. He is present in us, and he paid the price for us. God is love. Now here's the fourth part, and the final part. We also find here the promotion of God's love. The promotion of God's love. Look at verses 15 and 16, the conclusion of our passage this evening. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. God, or John, concludes this wonderful passage on God's love by highlighting once again our responsibility in the matter. You see, that's the promotion of God's love. We have a responsibility here. We've already looked at our responsibility in part. But let me conclude this responsibility that we have seeing these final few verses. First of all, we have the responsibility of promoting the love of God by our testimony. By our testimony. In other words, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God. You understand what it means to confess. It means to agree with God who God says Jesus is. And we're to confess Jesus is the Son of God. We're to confess Jesus is the Savior of the world. We're to confess that Jesus is exactly who he said he is. And when we do, he is the Son of God. God abides in him and he in God. In other words, God abides in us when we have that confession in our lives, when we have that testimony in our lives, when we promote the very love of God through the testimony of Jesus Christ. So by our testimony, we're promoting the love of God. Also by the truth, we are promoting the love of God. And we have known and believed that the love that God has for us. The issue is not about sincerity, but truth. The issue is not first sincerity and then truth. It is first truth and then sincerity. And believed the love that God has for us. First of all, it says we have known. In other words, we understand, we know the truth. And then we have a revelation of truth followed by sincerity. We know and then we believe. Did you understand? That's how we came to our faith in Jesus Christ. We don't just step out. Many people believe faith is stepping out blindly, but that's not what faith is. We have faith in God, not because we step towards Him blindly, but because we know that He is God. We know that Jesus is the Son of God. We know that He died for our sins. And so we have this truth, and then we step out on faith. We step out in sincerity. Sincerity in that which is false will never lead to the love of God. Just because someone is sincere does not make it right. Just because someone is sincere in the belief of a false deity does not make that deity real, does not make that deity true. Sincerity doesn't do it. In fact, sincerity sometimes will get you in trouble. I can sincerely believe that I'm the greatest athlete in the world and without any training go out and run a marathon. But after the first, I would say at this stage in my physical life, and after about 5 miles, I'll probably start collapsing and I won't make the marathon. You understand, sincerity isn't going to get me across the finish line. Our sincerity must first be led by truth. We believe in the truth of Jesus Christ, and then we sincerely believe we follow Him. So the promotion of God's love is first found by our testimony of Christ, but it's also found by the truth of God's Word. And then it's by our trust. The promotion of God's love will be seen if we trust in Him. God is love, and he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. To abide in God's love is to trust in his truth, to rely upon his Son, to obey his Word. Perhaps you'll recognize in him, trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. How do we demonstrate? How do we promote the love of God? We'll live in accordance to his Word. How can we say we love God and not read his Word? How can we say we love God and not live by his Word? How can we say we love God and not share his Word with others? See, that's the promotion of God's Word. By our testimony, by the truth, but by our trust in him. And our trust is when we believe, when we obey. Trust and obey. There's no other way. God is love. And so we found in this passage the provision, the purpose, the proof, and our promotion of God's love. You see, that's the faith that we profess. And I understand it to be a faith that loves. That's the way it goes with the Lord. Heavenly Father, we praise you. Thank you for allowing us to spend some moments in your Word this evening. Not nearly enough. Lord, my thoughts, my thinking, my words are never enough to describe your perfect love. But I know in the hearts of those who are present, perhaps those who are listening, that they have witnessed and they've known your precious love in their life. And so, Lord God, my prayer is that we will just live out that love, understanding that you are continuing to work within us to perfect your love, so that we can continue to share and demonstrate the love of Christ to others. Lord, thank you again for allowing us to spend time in praise and prayer and in the teaching of your Word. We love you, we praise you, and as always, it is in the precious and powerful name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Well, God bless you all. I hope you have a great and wonderful rest of the evening. I do look forward to baptism on Sunday morning, as well as And God bless all of you who joined us as well.